Penguin Random House Audio presents Scorpion Mountain by John Flanagan. Read for you by John Keating. Part 1. Castle Araluen. Chapter 1.
"War there, Tom! Steady on, fellow!"
Tom was a ploughhorse, well past middle age and resigned, like most of his placid breed, to the constant task of plodding up and down, hauling a plough that carved consecutive furrows in the rich earth of Halder Farm. He wasn't accustomed to being stopped in mid-furrow, and he turned his shaggy head to look at his owner, Devon Halder. Devon, like his horse, was well past middle age, and the smock that he was wearing was liberally daubed with patches of drying mud. Later that night, when he was asked in the local tavern what led him to stop and turn around, he couldn't really recall. Perhaps he had heard the slight sounds of creaking leather and rope, or the rustle of a sail in the brisk wind. Whatever it was enough for Devon to halt Tom and turn to face the river behind him. When he did, the sight that met his eyes sent a sudden jolt of panic through him. Barely 40 metres away, gliding smoothly up the river, was a ship. His first thought was that she was a wolf ship, and Devon was old enough to remember when the sight of a Scandian wolf ship on the river was a prelude to a sudden, savage attack. He tensed his muscles to run and spread the alarm in the nearby village, but he paused at the last second. The days when Scandians used to raid the coastal and river villages of Araluen were well in the past now. And besides, on second glance, this was no wolf ship. She was similar in style and shape, sure enough. She was slim-waisted and had a look of speed about her. She didn't have the broad, capacious lines of a cargo hull. But there was no large, square sail such as a wolf ship would use. Instead, this ship was rigged with a triangular sail that was mounted fore and aft along the line of the ship, supported by a long, gracefully curving spar that swept up high above the hull. She was smaller than a wolf ship. Also, at her bow post, there was no carved wolf's head, with raised hackles and snarling teeth. Instead, there was a carving in the shape of a bird's head, and there was a motif of a seabird in flight on the sail. A graceful bird, with wings spread wide. A heron, Devon realised. But the four circular, wood and metal reinforced shields arrayed down the starboard bulwark were unmistakably Scandian in design, although he noticed that a fifth shield, set level with the helmsman's position, was shaped like a triangle. The crew, those he could see, were dressed in Scandian fashion, with leather and sheepskin vests and leggings held secure by crisscross bindings. Yet he saw none of the horned helmets for which the Scandian sea wolves were well known, the sight of which would strike fear into any honest farmer's heart. Instead, several of them wore dark woolen watch caps, rolled down to cover their ears against the cold. As he watched, the figure at the helm raised a hand in greeting. Devon shaded his eyes to look more closely at the helmsman. He appeared to be quite young, and relatively slim for a Scandian. The person beside him was more like a typical sea wolf, Devon thought. He was bulky, with wild grey hair blowing in the wind. As Devon watched, he realised that the second man had a wooden hook in place of his right hand. Definitely a sea wolf type, he thought. But then the man made a similar gesture of greeting. Devon returned the wave cautiously. His suspicions were still raised. Small as she might be, this was definitely a cruiser, a raiding ship. She was fast, lean-hulled, and potentially dangerous. And, as the shields arrayed down her bulwark attested, her crew were fighting men. He watched her closely as she sailed past, gradually pulling out into the centre of the river to round the approaching bend. The helmsman and his companion lowered their hands and seemed to lose interest in the elderly farmer and his ploughhorse.
That'll give him something to talk about in the tavern tonight, Thorn said with a grin. Probably the most exciting thing that's happened to him since his plough got stuck on a tree root 5 days ago. Hal raised an eyebrow. Us? Exciting? Thorn nodded, scratching his rump with the blunt end of his wooden hook. He was a greybeard. He'd remember the times when the sight of a Scandian ship meant a raid. I'm surprised he didn't go pelting off to raise the alarm when he saw us. Thorn had no idea how close the farmer had come to doing just that. As they rounded the bend, and the farmer and his horse disappeared from sight, Clouf planted her forepaws onto the starboard bulwark and gave out a single bark. Then, content that she had asserted her superiority over all things Araluen, she dropped back to the deck, slid her front feet, and flumped down onto the planks. For a few seconds, she watched Hal out of one eye. Then she sighed and settled back to sleep. Hal cast his gaze over the tilled fields and green forests that lined the banks of the river. It was attractive country, he thought. Did you ever raid an Araluen, Thorn? He asked. The old sea wolf shook his head. Arik preferred to raid the Iberian coast, and sometimes Gallica or Sunderland. And now that I've seen Gilan in action with that bow of his, I'm glad he did. Maybe Arik knew something. Imagine facing half a dozen archers with Gilan's skill and speed. Facing one would be bad enough, Hal agreed. Stig was sitting on a coil of rope several meters away, idly putting an edge on his already razor-sharp saxknife as he listened to their conversation. Do you think Gilan will be at Castle Araluen yet? He asked. Originally, they had planned to leave Cresthaven Bay at the same time as the Ranger, who was riding overland back to the capital. But they'd had a long, hard voyage south to Socorro, and Hal wanted the Heron in tip-top shape for her first appearance at Castle Araluen. There were some sections of running rigging that had frayed and needed splicing and repairing, and there was a large, splintered gash in one of the planks on the waterline, where they had nearly run aground, pursuing Terzgood's renegade ship Nightwolf through the shoals. It took half a day to plane that smooth and repaint the timber so there was no sign of the damage. In addition, Edvin wanted to replenish their stores and fresh food, and suggested that they should do it at Cresthaven, where the village was contracted to supply their needs as part of the duty ship agreement. No point spending our money elsewhere when they'll provide it for nothing here, Edvin had said, and Hal agreed. As a result, they sailed out of Cresthaven and headed north to the river mouth some 2 days after Gilan had ridden off, waving farewell as he topped the rise above the bay where they were moored. He should be, Hal replied to Stig's question. It's a little over a day's ride, and I'm told those ranger horses cover ground at a prodigious rate.
He can have the welcome committee ready for us then, Thorn added. Maybe this king of theirs will come down to the jetty to greet us.
Hal smiled sidelong at his old friend. From what I've heard of kings, they don't stand around on windy jetties waiting for roughneck sailors to arrive.
Do you consider yourself a roughneck? Thorn asked. I've always thought of you as quite sophisticated.
I may be, but you're roughneck enough for all of us, Hal told him. And Thorn grinned contentedly.
Yes, I'm glad to say I am.
Farther forward, in the waist of the ship, and with no responsibilities to attend to during this current long reach of the river, the twins were bickering, as they were wont to do. They had been silent for some time, much to the crew's relief. But that was a situation too good to last.
You know that brown-eyed girl who was sitting on your lap at the welcome home feast? Ulf began.
Wulf eyed him suspiciously before replying.
Yes, what about her?
Ulf paused, smiling quietly to himself, preparing to throw out his verbal challenge.
Well, She fancied me, he said. Fulf looked at him, eyebrows raised. She fancied you? Ulf nodded emphatically. So, you noticed too.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.